Good evening. I'm Clive Barnes, dance and theatre critic for the New York Post. Welcome to Metro Art 13 and the studio of dance photographer Lois Greenfield. All this week we are celebrating the world of dance, from students to performers, master teachers to choreographers. In our first programme tonight, we'll have an opportunity to see the passing on of a major dance legacy from one generation to another. When I die, George Balanchine has said, everything should vanish. He did not expect his ballets to survive. And if it were up to him, they would no longer be seen. But his dancers are living on. Balanchine left his work largely to some of his principal dancers, who banded together to ensure that the Balanchine flame will be kept alive well into the next millennium. Now, Balanchine lives.
Balanchine seems to grow in popularity even since his death, which is, we had some questions about whether or not that would happen. I think it's safe for one thing. He was good at shaking everybody up and sometimes doing a work that no one expected, which startles them. He's not going to do that anymore. We know where we are with him. The work has fulfilled all of our expectations, all of the expectations of the critics and the dance historians. But of course, the main thing is that the work is so great, that there's a whole library of wonderful ballets, no two alike, that is such a treasure trove for every artistic director planning a season.
About 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2. A little bit less legs. And Bori, and 1, 2.
If you need an abstract ballet, neoclassical ballet, they're the best ones. If you want a dramatic work of charm and fantasy, absolutely delightful, Midsummer Night's Dream is perfect. Rubies is fun and jazzy and American, but still classical and neoclassical.
Hey, girls, ready? 5, 6, 7, 8, 3, 2, 3, 4, go. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, good.
A rich tutu ballet, theme and variations for all the fans of traditional classical ballet.
Point your feet.
Six, seven, eight.
Everything you could possibly want is there for the asking, almost.
And up and two and three. Head Charlotte. Charlotte, la tête, la tête. A droite.
Preserving Mr. Balanchine's ballets is the most important thing right now. Like a composer, if we changed his music or left out a note, that would be disastrous. And the same for Mr. Balanchine. It's like every hand, every foot, every movement, every count, every precision, everything we do requires that detail. And he wanted that in his works, and I believe that's how we keep them alive. I mean, he's still alive in them to me.
As time went on, as Balanchine was approaching, say, 70, people would start asking him what his thoughts were about the future of his ballets, future of his dancers, future of his company and the school. And I remember that I had a long interview with him when he was just approaching 70 years old, in which I asked him the question forthrightly, what's going to happen after you're gone? Who's going, he said. He said, I'm a Georgian, if that's Georgian in the Soviet Union. I'm a Georgian, he said, and I'll probably live to 135. Georgians live very long, you know. And then after that, when I returned to that question, he said, what's the matter with now? Why do people ask about the future? Now is when it is beautiful. Now is when it's good. Now is when people should care.
Big step over two, down and a hands way up, open and big through and not too low on this one.
I know that there was a time when Balanchine sort of didn't care what happened to his ballets after he died, but near the end of his life, he didn't say to me specifically, but I know that he changed his mind about his ballets, that he realized that they were going to be taken care of. And that is why I think when he died, he left his ballets to individual people that he knew and loved and trusted, instead of just leaving them to New York City Ballet, which is a board of directors, basically. And as far as I know, he was the first choreographer who left his ballets to individual people. I mean, especially this vast repertoire that he had. And I think it was another stroke of genius from him to do this, because these people care about his ballets.
The fact that Balanchine had made a will and that a Balanchine Trust was established made it possible for almost the first time in dance history for an entire legacy of dance to be passed on, or at least to have the possibility of being passed on. His will, I think of, as a kind of crux in the history of the transmission of dance.
The George Balanchine Trust came about because of the way Mr. Balanchine had designated the intellectual properties, his ballets, to various legatees. Mr. Balanchine left his ballets in his will. He took these ballets and he gave a certain number of works to one individual, and then he took the same number of works and gave different rights to two individuals, and so on and so forth through the will. So almost a month after Mr. Balanchine died, those of us who had shared rights came together and said, how can we make these ballets, how can we bring them together and make them a whole? What kind of umbrella do we need?
What's very interesting with the Balanchine Trust is that it spread around a group of people with a kind of individual understanding of his work, but with the same idea around. So it keeps on the very specific work from Mr. B, but with a very personal lecture each time, depending on who's going to set which ballet.
One. And now go front, please.
Yes. I know that each time I ask the trust to have a ballet from Mr. B, I also point out a little bit which person I would like to have to set it, because I do know that between Pat Neri, Karin von Aroldingen, and other people, the spirit that will be given to the piece will be different. So I think it's a very interesting way of doing it. If it will be held by one person, I think it will be dangerous. But if it's held with different people, different brain, different mind, different aspect of approaching the dance, then it has a very good sense.
The benefit that a company has outside of the New York City Ballet is they acquire a ballet from the embryonic stage. So, first of all, they've made a decision that they want that ballet. And they've programmed it, and they have an idea in their mind what it's going to be like. Then you send the repetiteur, ballet master, to stage that ballet. And that ballet master has maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, depending on the length of the work, to rehearse that company every day and create that ballet from this first step. So it is already vital by the time the premiere comes.
Here we are. Karin. It's a hard door.
Good morning.
Yes.
The six ballets he left me, four of them, they were done on me. And so it's like he gave me a present. He gave me a gift. But you know, I'm not the only one. And also, whoever dances his work, it's present. Just to perform it, you know, and then having something done for you is like, you know, I mean, I can't describe the feeling. I remember him always saying towards the end, I mean, the older ballerinas, he said, you know, you're disciples now, you're on your own. So we had to make sometimes many decisions, and it's hard now not him being with us anymore, but there are messages we get, and when sometimes you get stuck, there's somehow is a way, because his work is so organic too, visually so logical, that we always find a way to go on with it. And of course now we have a big responsibility, because we have to train the next generation to keep up with that level, the quality level of his work. So,
where are you, Karin? Karin van Aroldingen. No. Karin. Okay. Elle était juste à Monte Carlo. Elle est remontée à Polola. Elle est venue ici. Et Sarah Leland, qui va assister. Et bon, on va faire les distributions maintenant. Et on peut dire Sally. It's okay? We can go, Sally. It's okay. Beautiful.
Well, I was very excited when I heard that Toulouse wanted Liebeslieder also, since it hadn't gone in Europe for over 17 years. And at the same time, I was a little bit worried, since I didn't know the dancers there. When I came here, we watched some classes, and Lynette pointed out some dances which she thought would be right for this and this part. And of course, we choose several casts and worked with them to find out which one would be more suited for which part. So it was like a little auditioning.
So much move there.
Yes.
The tempis are, I mean,
are really very much integrated.
Should,
but for instance,
is what to follow the choreography, you know.
Some of
which one for instance?
But just some of them seem a hair fast musically to me. For this one. I feel it, on the tape it seems to me.
No way.
Okay, no.
Then I don't know what tape you have.
Maybe I just did. It's in the first impression.
We know he was a great musician, and before he would choreograph, he would play the whole score. He knew much better than some of the musicians what music is all about. He would visualize music. And he brought out, as it was said often, that you could see the music and hear dance.
First you go this upstage.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now.
There is two persons with who I like personally work from the Balanchine Trust, is Patricia Neri and Karin von Aroldingen. They're very different. Karin has an approach that is much more discreet in a way. She is giving information to the dancer that they have to pick up and do something with it. Pat, she has a tremendous amount of energy to bring the, she still dance. You know, it's such hard work to be a dancer. You need so much will, so much energy, so much strength that you need to be pushed sometime. I believe that people should be able to do it themselves. And maybe having Pat all day long, I always tell her, for a year will just be death at the end. But for a period like that, it's a kind of whip that just bring everybody together.
To last 5 hours in porn shoes now is very difficult for me, but I sometimes forget, because I do love so much to teach his ballets on point. But I do see that the difference in my feet hurts a lot. It's called No Pain, No Gain. It's sort of like Arnold Schwarzenegger. And also I try to last as long as the dancers do, which isn't easy, considering I'm old enough to be their mothers. But don't tell anyone that. Oh dear. Now ladies, you're all in, now you're not gonna wear that stuff around your waist, are you? Huh? We're gonna look a little, I mean, I don't mind you in black, but you're not gonna wear all that paraphernalia hiding. What is that? Skirts, pretty skirts, like Balanchine-like. What is that sweater bit, you know?
In 1968, about, I left the company, and a year later, I started teaching his works in Europe. And he would come often and watch me teaching his ballets, and it was just such an incredible moment for me, a knowledge, to have him sitting next to me telling me what he wanted, which is something I never could have gotten when I was a dancer in the company.
One and two, three and four, da dee da one, da dee da two, da da, pull back, da. No, no, Natalie, two, darling. Girls, pull back, in English, pull back, yes. We miss this now, because you see, when Balanchine did this, it's not this way, it has to be, you go back. So each one of these, you're actually going back. You know, that's it, that's it. And don't put the, and put the body up, so you finish in a nice fourth, yeah? Okay, once more. Ready? And a one, and two, three, four, five, and one, good.
Balanchine is a manner, a style, an education that you have to grow up with. It's like learning a language. If you are going to stage a Balanchine ballet, it's incumbent upon you to find somebody who speaks that language very clearly and has full understanding. Susan Handel is a person who was there. She's an old colleague of mine from the New York City Ballet. Plus, she has a fantastic mind for this.
Devil a pet. But, yeah, but did you hear what I say to Franklin? Did you hear? No, because you guys were talking, right? So I just said we don't want it. We don't want that, right? You have to, this is the Balanchine thing, right? It's not plop. Everybody can do plop, okay? The whole thing is that you present, you don't make any noise.
With Mr. Balanchine, there's nothing that is uncoordinated. Okay. The way you move from one combination of steps to another combination of steps, the segue in between is a perfectly natural way to move. So it's, in many ways, it's, I wouldn't say easy to teach a Balanchine ballet. It is complex, but it's, for me, it's very familiar to my body, to my mind, to my musicality. On this particular project of Theme and Variations, I have asked Edward Villella to help me, because he did dance the premiere at New York City Ballet, and I am not a gentleman in the ballet, so therefore there are certain things about partnering that a gentleman would know better than a lady how to do. Yeah. So I have included him on this project because I find his information vital.
I'd just like to chat with you about this. I'm not sure that this is a throw. It's a throw to come down.
Yeah, that's
I think you're going too up, up. It's up to go down.
Picture down.
Up, down.
Around.
Yes.
Round. Down, round. It's an amazing ballet. It takes you through Emeralds, which is so romantic and moody, and then the Stravinsky Rubies, which is jazzy, and which is actually the first part that we did.
One, two, up.
It was so successful for us that everyone said, well, why don't you do the complete ballet? So I thought, well, if it's going to be done, I want it to be done well. I'm still the artistic director. And so this is my final gift to Pittsburgh and to the company, to the dancers. It's very demanding. And I think will be something that they all can work with for many, many years to come.
Up and back. Now front.
Pat Wild, who's the director here, comes to all of the rehearsals and she's overseeing, but she really is letting me just take control. She worked with Balanchine at a different time than I did. She worked with him before Jules was created, but she has very valuable comments, and I think everybody who worked with him, whatever at whatever period in their life, has something important to contribute to preserving the integrity of these works.
Elise Bourne was there when it was being done. So I feel that, you know, it's important for us to get that direct line to the creation of the ballet while those people are still available to us.
All together, Demi.
Our relationship to Balanchine is unique in the sense there's a continuity of France's relationship to the work. All other companies, one stager comes in and does one version, and then somebody else comes in and does another ballet that has a different sensibility. Because Francia has her hands on every one of the Balanchine ballets and takes loving care of them, there's a point of view that is consistent through all of our repertoire.
All of Balanchine's ballets, I go more by instinct than anything else, and that's the great benefit of having worked with him so closely as a dancer, as a teacher, as a ballet master.
Okay, the feeling of it is good. Some of the steps are missing. And also, Alexander, when you do this, you're suddenly getting very proper, and you should, you know, your head has to do something too on those arabesques.
So I know the places where he felt there were possible variations, and I know the places that were absolutely set, and there are moments in Symphony in C, for instance, where he turned to me one day in rehearsal, he'd explained it very carefully, and he said, one day, Francia, you will be the only person who knows exactly what this should be. Well, I don't think that's true. I'm sure there are other people who know as well, but I always felt that I had been given this sort of holy assignment of remembering. And I try to pass all of that on to our dancers here.
stand up, Becky. That's right.
He was a journalist. He's very charismatic. He's very intelligent.
Look at the grandness. Oh, little Venice here.
And then normally they have a big market here.
This ballet we're doing now here, Liebes der Walzer, it's a very romantic ballet. It's love songs. One is passionate, the other one is more, there's sadness and there's a happiness. And it's all in there, you know, all the elements of love, which is a great pleasure of passing on. The dancers are not, in a sense, really ballet dancers. They're women and men, or better to say, ladies and gentlemen. Because already the costumes make you behave a certain way in etiquette of that time, that period. See, these are not dancers.
Voilà.
Des chanteurs?
Voilà.
They're singers.
And you have this one.
See, we have the four, yeah. Well, we have to give names now to it, right? So we have Paola is this,
Farrell.
So this one.
Then I danced in Liebeslieder Walzer. And one of the most wonderful things about that ballet, I felt, was that we finally got a chance to waltz, which Mr. Balanchine felt was one of the most difficult things to do. And he worked endlessly with my male partner and myself and all the other three couples, and waltzing became one of the most beautiful things one would ever want to do in the world. That's what you felt when you were on stage in that ballet.
Tiara is wrong.
Tiara, no. Okay.
For this ballet, no, more flowers, no, a little bit rhinestone, a little bit of rain, but right? Yeah. But flowers mainly, lacy.
Les fleurs et les diamants.
Extraordinary costumes. You'd pick up the girl's beautiful long dress, and under the dress was French lace, and under that there were three layers of that. And I remember Karinska was getting us new costumes one season, and she said, "Oh, Mr. Balanchine, the lace is too expensive that comes from Paris now." And he said, "No, that's what we have to have. We have to have the best. I don't care if it's not seen, because the women that are wearing them know that it's French lace."
10 chaises.
10 chaises.
Et deux banquettes.
Alors, en principe, 10 chaises, deux banquettes, deux tabourets pour le pianiste,
oui,
et deux tabourets pour les chanteurs.
Voilà.
The trouble is, I don't understand if the singers and the pianists are in the style dressed.
Yes, they are, yeah.
Seated on modern seats.
Well, it's simple. It's just simple. You don't even...
Yeah.
It's not a really set period. And you can mix modern with, you know, period things. Mm-hmm. It works because, I mean, most important thing is what's going on right here in the center.
When I danced it, before I even danced, one step, it was like we were transformed in another time. And the music started, it was like you were in another world, not existing on this earth.
One and two and three and four.
The Liebeslieder Walzer ballet. It's probably one of the greatest, if not the greatest, statement of romantic love in any of the art forms in our century. When I heard that it was being done in Toulouse, I was very eager to go see it, especially being taught by Karin von Arldingen, who was Balanchine's very dearest of friends in the last decade and a half, let's say, of his life, who loved him dearly, and he loved her.
Good.
Her task with the Toulouse people was to take those very young dancers and imbue them with a kind of sophistication and grandeur that they hadn't quite dreamed of yet. it was quite inspiring to see it happening.
Use your head too, to look away from her. She's so beautiful, you can't stand it, you know. Yeah?
That's what it is. It's not that you don't like her. It's that she's so beautiful.
She does.
You can't bear the
sight
of her
blinded.
Anymore.
She's blinded. So really, use your head too, don't do this.
Did you hold that?
Like this.
During our beginning, I was not sure, and I switched people around. And I think now I have the perfect cast, and it's wonderful to see the enthusiasm, the way they work, and every day is another progression. Mr. Valentin once said, you know, waltz is difficult because you have two legs, but it's in three.
Big step, and big. You take this hand, it's very slow, a little slower, like in an embrace, right? And now she, don't take yet the hand. She hasn't offered it yet to you. Don't anticipate. She offers it, then she sees it. Ah, she says, no, I changed my mind. Here we go. No, no. It's very playful, you know.
To give the dancer the freedom is wonderful to see what comes out, you know. It's surprisingly sometimes what's happening, you know. All of a sudden, you don't expect it, you know. You see them in class, and in class they will look awfully, sometimes even awkward, and then all of a sudden, you know, they start blooming and rehearsing.
Okay,
and
good.
Finally, hopefully, we haven't performed it yet, but I think it will happen. They're on stage, not me.
Liebes Lieder is probably the example of the greatest invention in any of Balanchine's works. Every single moment is a perfect jewel of invention. He never repeats himself. It's four couples. It's a long work. And, you know, how many different ways can a man and a woman waltz together? Well, and it's obviously infinite. It seemed like joy for Balanchine to work on the ballet. And it's reflected in the ballet. I could watch it the rest of my life. If I were going to take one ballet away to a desert island, you know, like one book or one piece of music, I think it would have to be Liebes Lieder.
There is for me two reasons that Balanchine is a necessity for the Ballet of Monte Carlo. The first one is historical. For any young generation, it is important to remember where we come from. And Balanchine always had a big relation to Monte Carlo. The Princess Grace loved dance, and she loved particularly the work of Mr. Balanchine. And I think it's important for us, for the national company, to keep that in mind and to spread that around the world. Second reason for me, and it's the most important one, is that I believe that for any choreographer, any artist, any creators, that inspiration is nothing divine. Inspiration is only memory. And from memory, you can, with your experience, your vision of the world, bring new ideas, say again what's been said before, but with the aesthetic of today. And at that level, I think Mr. B is a very good reference for us choreographically, because he gives really the starting point from abstract ballet.
Just play that for them. This is you. It's great. This is called the genius, the master of music, the master of dance, knew everything about the orchestra, and you represent the orchestra.
And I think Mr. Balanchine in almost all of his ballets captured the feeling of the composer so well, and it's certainly in Bach, in this particular Concerto Barocco, he was always putting across to everyone that the core represented the orchestra, and then on top, the two ballerinas represented the two violins, the first and second.
Hey, stop, okay. We may say BMH, but just that you have to be au centre, oui? It's how you space yourself, yes, for the jeté, yeah.
The interesting thing about Barocco, and I didn't realize this when I was doing it, but I realized it when I was staging it and saw, sitting in the audience in rehearsal, and saw the violinists and then the dancers on stage, the violinists are perilously, their bows are perilously close to getting intertwined while they're playing. And that was what it should look like on stage with these two female dancers. You know, they were, I had seen, they were dancing too far apart, and I said, no, that's too easy. You have to be so close together. It's only because you move on one and she moves on two that you get out of each other's way.
Down and reach, finish the arm and stay. Good, okay.
For Balanchine, the music always came first. He insisted that we understand that this was not the only way, but it was the only way he could imagine working. Of course, he was trained as a pianist, and I think he always said he could have been Nathan Milstein, that he could have been as great a violinist. Milstein was his friend. He imagined himself as a musician as much as a choreographer.
Whenever Balanchine choreographed a ballet, it would normally be played the way it was originally intended by the composer. And of course, we know that people take great, great liberties musically, and especially the Russians. They showed us this drawn out, pulled apart kind of approach to musicality, which really is simply to make an individual dancer comfortable. It's basically what it is, rather than facing the challenge and dealing with the challenge. So consequently, Balanchine appears very quick. He doesn't appear quick, he is quick. It is strictly in the time, within the phrasing.
I am okay. Guys, I think in the big Polonaise, I think we should be on
his choreography becomes the music. It is the music. The integration between the music and the steps, the choreography, is so strong and is so in one. They are in one with each other.
Balanchine had this wonderful phrase. He said that we dance upon the floor. The floor upon which we dance, however, is the music. Plus, he didn't just lay out the music for you. He showed you all of the phrasings. He showed you how they linked one phrase to another. And that's the same thing that we do as dancers. It's not the step. It's that in-between stuff that really gives you this tremendous sense of movement.
Theme and Variations was created in the 1940s. It's very elegant, it's very classical. It's Tchaikovsky, which is another good reason why he probably wanted to use this music. He revived it for the New York City Ballet. Edward Villella danced the premiere with Gelsey Kirkland. Later on, I was then put into what to be one of the four demi-soloists in Theme and Variations and danced it for quite a few years. It's based on Tant du battement, and Tant du battement is usually the second step that we do at the bar when we start class. We start with pliés, and then we start with have Tant du battement. It was a very common step, the first combination of the ballet, but he wanted you to swing with it. He would always say, no, dear, swing, you have to swing. You know, it was late 60s, early 70s, it wasn't the 40s anymore. So he wanted a very different stylistic quality, which was freer and also probably faster too, because he made us dance really very much at the speed of light. And again.
When we first rehearsed the first pas de deux, I remember Peter Martins did the pas de deux very slowly, and after we learned it, Mr. Balanchine came in, and it was supposed to be double time. I mean, he, you know, and Peter and I looked at each other, and I said, I'll never be able to, and we kept working, and it got better and better, never perfect. That's a ballet that I think is one of the hardest for the ballerinas. Five, six, seven, eight, nine.
To stage a Balanchine ballet on a company that has not been trained and is not acclimated in that area can be very difficult. When Balanchine first was brought to America by Lincoln Kirstein, Lincoln wanted him to make an American ballet company, and Balanchine said yes, but first a school.
Heel weight. Place.
There were schools, many schools, in the United States, but they were run by people who were trained in a 19th century manner and style.
Heel go.
All of the steps are the same. It's simply the approach to those steps. And that is where the difference lies. It lies in the class. And that's where you begin to prepare for Balanchine.
One.
We were taught every day by him in class, every single morning, hour and a half class, very difficult class. You could work one day on Port-de-Bras, nothing else. It sounds simple, you know, you lift your arms up and you put them down. He explained it in his unique way. He showed. So you'd stand there, there'd be 60 dancers, and we'd all be trying to do what he wanted. And if you turned your hand in too much, no, it's not right. He got us to learn how to use our hands exactly the way that we were to use them. Then he'd rehearse, he'd choreograph, and he would trust us because he knew he'd taught us.
In our training, when we were little kids at the Balanchine School, they would make us hold our hands like this. I don't know if you had, yeah, like this. The first year we had to do this. And it was a way, I'll tell you, it was a way to trick us to hold the shoulders down, because there's no way you can do it. I mean, you have to go like that. And then the second year, then we just open the hand and we always had the right relation. But it's the same thing as if I'm telling you to hold your shoulders down and hold your arms from your back. Do you remember? Did you, yeah.
You can teach steps.
Christine was at the school.
You can stage a ballet and be very fastidious and very caring about being the steward of these ballets. But what I try to do is also implement and augment the choreography with what happened in the classroom, because that's where all his ideas came from. That's not always possible when you're sent out to some country to stage a ballet. You have a short amount of time. You don't know the dancers. You only see them for that short duration that you're working with them. And you really want to make sure that they get the essence of what Balanchine is like. And it was not just a technical aspect, it was also a philosophy, because how you dance is who you are. And if you're not going to be honest as a person, then you're not honest as a performer.
This is off the ground, flex, good Angela, and I could keep it an Alice God and keep the back up, other side. Good.
The first piece we got or received from the Balanchine Trust was Allegro Brillante. And since I am interested in that the company grows further with Balanchine, and there's no way it would without Balanchine, I talked to Nanette and I said, what is possible for us with only 18 dancers, and what is suitable, and what can they technically master? What work do you recommend to me? And she mentioned Donizetti Variations, and she showed me the video, and I thought it'd be a wonderful piece for us. And so now it happened.
No, it's very important that a company, you know, they take a ballet that makes them look good. I mean, that's very important. And of course, there are other questions. He has to fit it in. It has to be first on the... He wanted a good opening piece. This is a very exciting opening ballet as well. It's quite technical. It's very classical. And it would show his best classical dancers to their advantage here. Okay, the step is right, basically right, but you have to move a little bit more out. After you've done this lunge, okay, after you go here, step jeté, then travel, assemblé together. This is another Balanchine thing. The second leg, it's like there's Velcro on your tights. Okay, the second leg is always predominant, like in tombe pas de brie, assemblé, like this. Okay? The European training is generally more square in its musicality. They do not do enough, you know, okay, if I talk ballet, tendu battement, which is the use of the foot on the floor. Balanchine schooling, we do at least 25 minutes of these exercises to develop the reflex of moving faster with the feet. For us, it has to be second nature because the choreography most of the time is so fast and the feet have to be beautiful doing it.
The curtain's still going down. Finish. Okay, all right. Well, now you know.
As Balanchine pulled out who you were as he was choreographing, I'm sure these dancers or these stagers do the same thing. They give a structure and a musicality. And then, you know, Balanchine used to say, I suggest, but the dancer does. And so you don't want to be overbearing when you stage or even when you teach. You say, you know, this is a suggestion. This could happen if you moved like this. What do you think? And the same with staging. Maybe you could do it this way. Maybe you could do it that. In the end, it has to be your thing. You coming out of yourself and moving within a framework to the music, but it's you who's doing it.
From this pas de châle, run, run, run. Pas de châle, lift around. You stay behind him to here. And you can look to me. That's better. And now just run with her and lift your pas de châle around. I'm pretty conservative when it comes to preserving the choreography. These are works of art, the same as a Picasso or a Rembrandt, except that they're living, breathing works of art. And I don't feel that it's incumbent upon me to change the steps. On the other hand, Mr. B was prone to allowing the dancer to contribute his or her own interpretation of whatever he gave. He used to look at us when he was creating or changing something and say, well, you know, what can you do? And he would let you show something. So he was the first one to allow individuality. And I think that's nice too. I like to see what that dancer will bring to the role themselves within the parameters of you have to do this step on this count in this spot with that arm looking this direction. And it sounds very contradictory, but it's how I feel about the ballets.
It wasn't just steps he wanted from you. He wanted you to bring a certain atmosphere or to recognize the atmosphere that he was offering you to create with. For instance, my solo in The Jewels is a solo which has so many aspects to enjoy. The reveling in arms movements at the beginning, the elegance of it, the independence of it, the richness of it. You were endowed with complete beauty of presentation, glamour, revelation of yourself completely, and he would allow you to go all the way. The whole thing was like a wonderful gourmet dinner with him.
She stays behind, and it's to him she opens a fossé. We have here restored some of Violette Verdi's original choreography, and we did that by obtaining a video cassette that Violette sent to us of her dancing this role in Emeralds. And I like the dancers to see her doing it because I can't dance like Violette. And I don't want them to emulate me, certainly. So I like it when they can see this video and use that as a point of departure. Front from there.
Okay, Lisa, the problem is that this group should not be further downstage than the others, and Jody and
Gavin, do go on.
There's a very fine line in staging a Balanchine ballet between being such a stickler for specifics that the ballet loses its life, and on the other hand, of interpreting in a personal way, which I try not to do. In a ballet like Midsummer Night's Dream, certainly I talk to the dancers more about the motivation of the characters than Mr. Balanchine ever would have done. He didn't believe in that. And in fact, he's right that all of the drama is in the choreography. It, in a way, it doesn't need to be discussed. But sometimes, knowing my dancers so well, I feel I can draw more out of them if I explain more.
I should read you, I should bring the play and read to you the things he says to her before you make this entrance. Did you read it? Okay. Well, read your lines again. You're a hateful human being, Jeff.
The way the plot of the play and the music are so interwoven so seamlessly and perfectly, it seems to me that Balanchine put the score together first and then made the play fit. The plot doesn't always follow the exact sequence of the Shakespeare play, but the characters are most perfectly realized and they're exactly like the characters in the play. So obviously, Balanchine related very closely to the Shakespeare drama.
Dan. Shh. You have to make a really big thing of shh to the audience as you run off.
He said that he could recite the play by heart, but only in Russian. And of course, he claimed that Shakespeare was much more interesting in Russian anyway.
Wait, this is the first one. You're still down.
When I learned the role of Bottom in A Midsummer Night's Dream, Mr. Balanchine immediately saw that I could turn into a donkey.
Somebody takes the book, Nick.
And so he started to play with this situation, and he inserted just a few little funny jokes about, well, now, you didn't see her do that, but you know that she's getting food, and so you're getting excited. And I put in a few of my own, and I actually made him chuckle a time or two, and we had a wonderful time with this head that made you completely become something else. You totally lose yourself.
I had the opportunity to watch Balanchine choreographing Midsummer Night's Dream, which he did in about 1962, and it was one of the great experiences of my life. One of the things Balanchine enjoyed very much about doing this ballet was that he could incorporate lots of little children from the School of the American Ballet, and he loved seeing them there. He was always very nice to the children and courteous to them, treated them with a kind of respect which was almost un-American. It was so decent. And I think part of his pleasure was the memories it evoked in him of when he had been studying at ballet school. He wasn't very happy in the school, didn't like it very much. But then he got included as a child in a ballet on the stage that had children. And that was a magical experience for him and transformed his whole school experience because he now saw what it was all about. So he used children, and he used them whenever he could in other works as well, and things like The Nutcracker, of course.
This is one of the sweetest moments in the whole ballet. You guys are part of that. I feel that it's very beneficial to the preservation of his work that there is a point of view informing all the Balanchine work performed by our company. However, there's occasions when I think it's wonderful to have the infusion of another point of view. Karin von Araldingen and Bart Cook staged Violin Concerto for us, for instance, recreating their own roles that were choreographed on them. Suzanne Farrell did Mozartiana, and Susan Hendel and Sarah Leland have done several things for us, Christine Redpath. These are wonderful ballet masters, and they have brought stagings of works that I didn't dance personally, and so that their memories were very fresh and important. That being said, I do take care of the works once they're staged here, so I'm sure some of my feelings about Balanchine and my reflections on what he wanted are rub off on all of the works, and give the Balanchine repertory of Pacific Northwest Ballet its very special flavor.
Balanchine in his lifetime made 425 works, dance works, of one sort or another, for ballet, for musical comedy, for opera, and so on. Of those works, only 75 are now known, can be danced, approximately 75. That's for the number that was done in the Balanchine celebration in New York City in 1993 when they tried to do his entire body of work. The rest have disappeared. It didn't bother him. It would bother you and me if we had done that many works and they disappeared and could never be resurrected. He just used to shrug at that. That's the way it is.
Go under, good girl.
For every single choreographer, the day you give your step to another dancer, you accept you're going to be betrayed by them. And the big question is what they're going to be able to do, interestingly enough, with that betrayal. How many times a choreographer could hear, "I'm sorry, you didn't do that yesterday," and one of the dancers said, "Oh, yes, he did. Oh, no, I remember. I was there at the creation. That was not like that." Already, when you're alive, people don't agree on what it is because it's so fragile. It's so subjective. And I think it's not the most important. If the choreographer is alive, good. He will give his own opinion. If he's not alive, who knows really how Swan Lake should have been danced? What we do know is that it has a connection to the world of today or it doesn't. What I do know also is that each time I do a piece from Mr. B, for myself, I really believe strongly that that's the way he would have liked to see it.
Authenticity is, of course, highly desirable, but along with authenticity, there has to come vitality. How to keep these ballets not merely correct, but with all their wondrous vitality is the key effort. And it seems to me that that is being achieved remarkably in scores of companies throughout the world. Balanchine lives. He's living on in the bodies of those to whom these ballets are being transmitted.
To dance a Balanchine ballet for our company is pure pleasure, something they look forward to. They always look to see how many Balanchine ballets there are in a season. It's very difficult to tell which ones of them will go on in the profession and have careers as ballet masters and artistic directors. So I'm hoping to pass all of this to all of them and then see which ones will take it and run with it. They have to carry the torch in the next century and beyond because I want Balanchine's work to be preserved from that time that was so full of vitality and freshness and enthusiasm, of him never letting our energy flag, of always pushing us to do more. That's what I want them to carry on.
Right hands. You have to duck your head, your ears first.